The words of the Creed that speak of the third person of the divinity, of the Holy Trinity. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And in this confession of faith, in the God who has revealed himself to us, not as a single person, but as a communion of three persons who share the same divine being, the same divine essence, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God's self-revelation of himself to us is complete. With the revealing of the person of the Holy Spirit, we would say in the church that God has shown himself to us as completely as we are able to grasp him. Of course, we've said all the way through that although what has been revealed to us by God about himself is true, of course, on the one hand. On the other hand, the depths of the being of God, what makes God God, what makes the three persons unique in themselves, always remain an unfathomable mystery. Now, we're going to say concerning the persons of the Son and the Spirit, we've said it already concerning the Son, and we'll say it this evening about the Holy Spirit, that both these persons in God, of God, have their origin in the Father. The Father is the source of their being. It is the Father's Godness from which they come forth. We speak of the Son of God as being the only begotten of the Father, as being the perfect image of the Father, coming forth from the heart of the Father outside all time. Likewise, when we speak of the person of the Holy Spirit, the word that is used to describe his coming forth from the Father is the word proceed. The Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. We're going to talk about that later on this evening. The Son is begotten and the Spirit proceeds. What is the difference between the two? What is the difference between the begetting of the Father and the procession of the Son? In the end, it's impossible analytically to say. What is being said there, though, is that the persons of the Son and the persons of the Spirit are unique. They are distinct persons. And so, although both of them, the Son and the Spirit, have their origin in the being of the Father, their relation, each one of them, to the Father in this perfect communion of life that the three divine persons share is a unique relationship. The Son is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not the Son. They are not identical. They are unique persons. So, first of all, we need to examine what the Scripture tells us about the Holy Spirit. We begin that phrase in the Creed with, I believe in the Holy Spirit. We need to look at the word Spirit. In the Hebrew of the Old Testament, the word that is used for spirit is one of those words that sounds like what it means. It's the word ruah. And that sounds like a breath. And that's what the word means. Breath, or even it can mean air. Now, this word, when used in the scripture, we encounter it first at the beginning of the book of Genesis, at the very start of the account of creation, where it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was out without form and void. Darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God, as we read it, the breath of God, moved over the face of the waters. Now, this word for breath, this Hebrew word ruah, was translated into Greek as pneuma, and the Greek word likewise has the same connotation of breath. And even in English now, you know, if we don't pronounce the P and don't pronounce the U as a V, as they do in modern Greek, you know, if you have pneumonia, it's a disease of the breathing organism of the lungs. And the pneuma from the Greek into the Latin became the spiritus. And likewise, the root is the same. We speak of respiration. You know, it comes from the same root, the breathing. So the Spirit, as he is described in the Old Testament, is, we could say, though we have to be careful about the way we say it, is the presence of God, the person of God, that gives life. Sometimes the expression is used, the life force, but I want to be careful with that every time one uses the word force. The danger is of understanding that as some sort of depersonalized power. But here we are talking about a person. In fact, when in that account, at the very beginning of the book of Genesis, the church would see foreshadowed, even though our experience is that the three persons of God are not revealed in their fullness until the new covenant. Only with the Word, the Son of God, taking flesh and dwelling among us, and giving the promise to his disciples that he would send the Spirit, and then the promise being fulfilled and the Spirit coming. Only then are the three persons of God revealed in their fullness. But in the Old Covenant, the church sees many foreshadowings of this revelation of the God in three persons. As I just read, the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters at the beginning of the account in the book of Genesis. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. So in the first three verses of the Holy Scripture, we have the breathing of God and the Word of God. See, God speaks, "Let there be light," and there was light. And we've said already that when God speaks, the word that he speaks is the Son that comes forth from the heart of his being, because the name of the Son of God is the Word of God, Son of God, Word of God. They are identical. And likewise, the Spirit of God that will accomplish the transformation of the matter that is created into living forms. When the creation of the human being comes, it's said that God breathes into the human being the breath of life, and man becomes a living soul. So the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the breath of God, is that person of God which makes life to be. The 32nd Psalm also expresses it very beautifully when speaking of the creation. It says, "By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and by the spirit of his mouth all their host." So the Son of God and the Spirit of God are the two persons through which the Father is revealed. One of the great teachers of the early church, Saint Irenaeus, the Bishop of Lyon, I think we've mentioned him before. He's one of the, we could call him a third generation Christian. He speaks of himself as somebody who knew those who had known the apostles, you see, three generations from the beginning. He knew personally Saint Polycarp, who knew personally Saint John the Apostle. There we have one of the, a very concrete example of the passing on of the tradition of the church's faith. And Saint Irenaeus speaks of the Son of God and the Spirit of God. He uses the analogy, a physical analogy, of the two arms of a person. He says the Son and the Spirit are the two arms of God. That, of course, does not mean that God the Father has arms any more than God the Father has a right hand on which Christ is sitting, a physical one. But it's a good analogy if we understand it properly, because just as the arms of a human being are the physical means through which we work, we act with our arms, so likewise the Son of God and the Spirit of God are the persons through which the Father is revealed. We know the one true and only God because he reveals himself through his Son and through his Holy Spirit. And we are not, of course, speaking here of three independent gods, because precisely the origin of the beings of the person of the Son and the person of the Spirit is in the Father. The Son is the Son of the Father. The Spirit is the Spirit of the Father. Only the Father do we speak of as being without origin. Many of the prayers conclude that way. We glorify the Father who has no origin. The Son and the Spirit do have an origin. It is not an origin in history or time. It is not to say that the Son of God, the Spirit of God, have a beginning. They do not, because their origin is in the being of the Father. Just as the Father is eternal, they are eternal. But their divinity, their divine nature, is the Father's. Without the Father, there is no Son, there is no Holy Spirit. So we do not have three beings here who are divided from one another. Rather, we have this perfect communion of sharing the divine essence in the persons of the Holy Trinity. We were speaking of foreshadowings of this we would say in the church, this communal life of the persons of the Godhead, that they have this perfect communion. In fact, when we speak of the communion that the members of the church are called upon by God to share, we say that we are to reflect the communion of love that is eternally in the persons of the Holy Trinity. And when we in the church read such verses as the 26th verse of the first chapter of Genesis, when it says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness," that divine plural. You see, God speaks even in the Old Testament in the plural. And it's not clear why he does so. There's no explanation there of why God speaks in the plural. But it happens frequently. Later on in the book of Genesis, in the story of the Tower of Babel, which we're going to refer to later, when God observes, as it's described there in the 11th chapter of Genesis, another attempt of the human being to seize prerogatives that belong only to God, to build this tower that will reach to heaven. It's a kind of symbol of man wanting to have complete independent power apart from God. And so the Lord's response in that description is that the languages of mankind become confused, so they cannot communicate with one another. And God says, "Come, let us go down," and they're confused their language. See, later on in the book of Genesis, we have this appearance to Abraham by God, who comes in the form of three angels. God appears to Abraham in the form of three angels in the 18th chapter. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham by the oak trees of Mamre as he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day. So he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing by him. And then as we read on in the story, it's clear that these are not three human beings. These are three heavenly beings. It's not the same as the incarnation, for example, when the Son of God literally takes flesh. This is a vision or an appearance when God chooses to manifest himself through a physical appearance, but he chooses to do so to Abraham in this triple revelation, the three men or the three angels. Another place in the prophecy of Isaiah, when Isaiah has his vision of God in glory in the temple and is called by God to become a prophet, God asks, who will go for us? Again, speaking in the divine plural. So, in all of this expression of the plural, the church sees a foreshadowing of the Father whose Son and Spirit reveal the Father to the human race, whose Son and Spirit are the means through which all the Father's plan for the salvation of the human race is accomplished. This Hebrew word, ruah, it's the wind also, breath, air, or wind. It's an expression of the mysteriousness of God's acting, because the wind you cannot see, but you know it is moving. The wind, likewise, on the day of Pentecost is going to be the revelation of the coming of the Spirit, although we're going to see that sometimes when we read that account of the descent of the Spirit on Pentecost, we think that it's a wind and fire. But if we read the account carefully, it says the sound came to the apostles like a mighty rushing wind. It doesn't say a wind came. It says something came like a mighty rushing wind. And then it says tongues as of fire. See, not simply tongues of fire, but tongues as of fire. So that what's being described there is something far beyond the physical description that's given to it. It's ultimately something that is beyond words to describe. So the Holy Spirit is confessed in the Creed as being the Lord. That is, of course, to say that the Holy Spirit is God in the same sense that the Son is God from all eternity, that the origin of his being, as we said, is in the Father. Because it is the Holy Spirit of God within God's plan for our salvation that makes everything that is accomplished through the Son work. See, that's the whole New Testament is an account of, on the one hand, what the Son does. The Son takes to himself human flesh and human sin and human death so that he might accomplish the way of escape for the human race. He teaches the word of truth, but the work of the Son is not all. Something else must follow. And Jesus gives to his apostles the night before Good Friday. It's described for us in the Gospel of St. John. He says that there's something more to happen with the apostles. He says, I'm reading from the 14th chapter of St. John's Gospel, the 26th verse. The helper, this translation reads, the Greek would say the paraclete, the paraclete, the parakletos, in Greek really means the advocate or the lawyer. See, the lawyer is supposed to help you. The helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things, and bring to your remembrance all things that I have said to you. And then later on in the 16th chapter, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, again the Helper, the Paraclete, will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Earlier on in the 15th chapter, when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. And you also will bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. So what Jesus is saying there, that everything that he has done, everything that he has taught his apostles, everything that's going to be accomplished in him and through him, through his death, burial, and resurrection, something else has to happen. Someone else has to come. And it is not until this someone else comes, this Helper, this Holy Spirit, that we could say the seed really germinates and begins to grow. When the Lord, risen from the dead, appears to his disciples on Easter night, on the night of Easter Sunday, when he comes to his disciples through the closed doors, the first thing he says to them is peace be with you. He gives him his peace. And then he says, as the Father has sent me, so I also send you. And then we are told that Jesus breathed on his disciples, the breath, the ruah, the pneuma, and said, receive the Holy Spirit. And then he gives them the authority to forgive the sins of human beings. Whoever sins you forgive, they are forgiven. Whoever sins you retain, they are retained. So it's interesting, by the way, we're very close to concluding the Inquiry series, and then those of the Inquirers who are ready to enter the catechumenate of the Church to begin preparing themselves for being joined in communion with the Church, they're made catechumens in a prayer during the Divine Liturgy, in which the first thing the priest does before he says the prayer to them is that he breathes on them, on the new catechumens, in the form of a cross. And see, this is the same breathing that we have described in Genesis as God breathing into man the breath of life, and the same breathing that Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit upon the disciples and gives them that same breath to be given to the Church. So it's this giving of life, the Holy Spirit, the giver of both, we would say, both the physical life and the spiritual life, both the life of this world. It is through the Holy Spirit that the Lord transforms inanimate matter into living beings, calls all things from nothingness into being. He calls into being by his word, by his Son, and he breathes the life through his Spirit. Likewise, the life of the new creation, the eternal life, the life of the kingdom of God, is through the breathing of the Holy Spirit. Now, it's very interesting because on the day of the resurrection, Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit upon the apostles, but they're not finished with receiving the Holy Spirit. See, 50 days later, 40 days later, first, Jesus ascends and tells the apostles to wait in Jerusalem for the fulfillment of the promise, and he says, you will soon be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Stay in Jerusalem until you are endued, until you are clothed with power from on high. So on the one hand, they receive the Holy Spirit from Jesus breathing upon them on the day of the resurrection, but there is a further receiving of the Holy Spirit for them, the great receiving of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. And we're to learn from that the receiving of the Holy Spirit cannot be narrowed down to one particular event, just as it was not for the apostles. But what happens on that 50th day the day of Pentecost, which, you know, we spoke last time about how the church loves to refer to the Lord's Day, the day of the resurrection, Sunday, as the eighth day, because it's the day beyond time, beyond the time of this world, the day in which God's time, God's acting, is revealed. But it was also on a first day of the week, on a Sunday, that the Holy Spirit descended upon the apostles, 50 days after the resurrection. See, 7 times 7 plus 1, always beyond the 7 of this world. And, of course, we're told in the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They meant the apostles, the 11. Mary, the mother of God, was there, and others, altogether numbering about 120, the scriptural account tells us. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And then the account goes on to tell us that all of the Jews who had assembled from the whole Greek and Roman world for the Feast of Pentecost, because it was one of the feasts that pilgrims came up to Jerusalem from everywhere, heard the apostles proclaiming the resurrection of Christ, each one in their own language. Excuse me. That is the miracle of Pentecost. The miracle of Pentecost is that the apostles speak in one language and are heard in many. See, a lot of times, this isn't the time that we're going to talk about this tonight, but a lot of times people can confuse the miracle of Pentecost with the speaking in tongues that is described in the first epistle to the Corinthians. But we're talking about something very different here. The languages that are being spoken on the day of Pentecost are human languages. And what's going on here is the reversal of what we just referred to when mentioning the Tower of Babel. See, in the Old Testament, human beings try independently to become God. And so the result is they lose the means of common communication. Their languages are confused. On the day of Pentecost, in the descent of the Holy Spirit on the apostles, the gift of God, the Holy Spirit is the gift of God, descends upon the apostles in the form of divided tongues as of fire, and brings them together, brings the languages back together, so that all the world can hear proclaimed that salvation is given, that the new life that has been made possible through the resurrection of Christ is made available for all. But it is only through the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles that this is possible. See, that's the important thing. That even though the apostles have been with Jesus, even though the apostles have heard his teaching, even though the apostles have witnessed him risen from the dead and ascend into heaven, they are still of themselves unable to be the means through which this good news of salvation is revealed to the world. Something else has to happen to them, and that something else is the coming of the third person of the Holy Trinity, the coming of the Holy Spirit who teaches all truth, so that as on the one hand, the Holy Spirit is the giver of life, both, as we said, the physical life and the spiritual life, the new life, the life of the kingdom, so also the Holy Spirit is the person through whom it becomes possible for human beings to know God. If before Pentecost the apostles had witnessed Christ and knew about him, It was still from the outside. And we see that continually expressed through the gospel, even the impatience of Jesus with the apostles, who are continually misunderstanding. You know, even after the resurrection, by the way, they've seen him risen from the dead, and we're told it must have been an amazing relationship, even to imagine about it for a second on the human level between the Lord and the apostles, because we're told even on the day of the ascension that the Lord upbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, and there are even confusing things then. I mentioned last time they're talking about the kingdom being restored to Israel. That's still how their notion of what's been accomplished, even in the resurrection, is still very human, very limited. But with the coming of the Holy Spirit, they don't know merely about Christ, about God. They know Him. They have moved from being outside to being inside. By the coming of the Holy Spirit, they enter the very communion of God's being, and so are able to be used by God as His instruments to make known what He has done to the world. And we see that in a very short period of time, only a couple decades, how much has been accomplished through these very weak vessels that receive the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, the giver of life and the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of true wisdom, who enables God to be known. Likewise, the Holy Spirit, we are told in the Scripture, descends upon Christ Himself at His baptism in the Jordan. We are told that Jesus comes up from the water. The heavens are opened, the Spirit of God descends on Him in the form of a dove, and the voice of the Father is heard. It's the first it's the first full revelation of the three persons of the one God. And the Spirit of God, we are told, accomplished this critical turning point in the human life of Christ, that for the first 30 years of His life, Jesus, as far as the eyes of men are concerned, as far as human history is concerned, is hidden. But when He is baptized and the Holy Spirit descends upon Him, His public ministry begins. The Gospel of Mark uses an even fairly violent term. It says, the Spirit drove Jesus out into the wilderness so that He would be tempted by the devil. So the work of His confrontation with evil begins. So it is the Spirit descending upon the Son of God incarnate in the flesh who reveals Him to be the Messiah. It is the Spirit descending upon the Virgin Mary that accomplishes the incarnation by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary. The angel Gabriel says to Mary, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you." The Holy Spirit is even described as being the Spirit of Him who raises Jesus from the dead. See, we could, I hesitate to use such a term, but perhaps it will serve as illustration. The Holy Spirit is the enabler of the Father. The Holy Spirit is the one through whom all of the Father's will is made to work. The Holy Spirit in the New Testament is always present with Jesus the Messiah, revealing Him to be the Messiah. He is poured out on the apostles, and once He is poured out, the apostles are able to proclaim who He is. He teaches them all truth. So, the teaching of the church is, since the Spirit is the one who makes God known, therefore it is necessary to confess the Spirit as being God, because no one less than a divine being could make God known to be who He is. It could not be a lesser being to reveal God, and since it is the Spirit who reveals God, The Spirit must be confessed as being God. So the Holy Spirit is Lord, Kyrios, as we said, of the Son, equal in every way with the Father. He is the giver of life. He proceeds from the Father. Now, we have to pause there in this expression of the relationship of the Spirit to the Father and to the Son, because it's very important in this confession of the Church's faith in the way by which the Spirit comes forth from the Father. We say he proceeds, and we say that he proceeds from the Father alone, that just as the Son is begotten, the Spirit proceeds. And this, we have to face here something that happened in the history of the Church, a great controversy over the procession of the Spirit that, of course, has very great and very deep ramifications in Christian history. And what I'm speaking of here is a term that all of you or most of you will have encountered already, the Latin term, the filioque. What happened is that the Western churches, the Latin churches, we're going to go into this in a little bit of detail because it's important, added a word in Latin to the Nicene Creed, where the original text of the creed reads, "I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father." The Latin church added the word, three words in English, one word in Latin. They say the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. Now, we reject this addition to the creed, and it's important for you to understand why it is we reject it and how it happened to come to be in Christian history. One, there are two reasons for this change in the creed. You know, the original expression comes directly from Scripture, from Jesus' words in the Gospel, that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. Why did the Western Church add the expression, he proceeds from the Father and the Son? It's for two reasons, one a theological one, and that is that our friend that we've mentioned before, I believe in reference to an understanding of original sin as inherited guilt, St. Augustine, who is a saint of the Church, but it's an example of how even being a saint of the Church does not necessarily mean that you have some opinions that are erroneous. See, that's why in Orthodox tradition we never would take one of the saints, one of the fathers of the Church, as we've mentioned before, and say, well, in the writings of this particular person, everything is expressed perfectly. Rather, the Orthodox tradition is to look through everything in its completeness, sift through it, and see how faithful the writings and teachings of any one person are in reference to the whole. Well, in the 5th century, early 5th century, when St. Augustine lived in North Africa, what is today Algeria, but would then be part of Roman North Africa and solidly Christian, he developed an explanation of the Holy Trinity that won a great deal of acceptance in the Latin Church. And this is basically what it is. He said that you have the Father, and of course, the Son is begotten of the Father. And between the Father and the Son, there is this great and eternal divine love. And St. Augustine spoke of the love, the mutual love, of the Father and the Son as the person of the Holy Spirit. And that seemed to many people to be one of the easiest to understand explanations of the Holy Trinity that had come along. Much perhaps more easy to understand than the mystery of the begetting of the Son and the proceeding of the Spirit. The problem with this explanation, though, in the light of the tradition of the Church, is that it's very dangerous. It's true, of course, that the Father and the Son love each other perfectly from all eternity. But to speak of the Holy Spirit as the love between the Father and the Son can make it sound, now it's not clear what St. Augustine's intentions were here, but can make it sound as if the Holy Spirit is being depersonalized, you see, and as is spoken of as coming mutually from the Father and the Son as a kind of lesser being, lesser person, rather than the traditional way of speaking of the Trinity is the monarchy of the Father, who begets Son, and the Spirit proceeds. And, of course, both the Son and the Spirit have the uniqueness of, have their origin in the Father. But this model of St. Augustine in speaking of the Holy Spirit as the mutual love of the Father and the Son seems to confuse the uniqueness of the origin of each person, the Son and the Spirit, in the Father. So that's the one of the principal theological origins of speaking of the Latin Church speaking of the Holy Spirit as proceeding from the Father and the Son. But the second explanation is historical. And by that I mean we're back to the Arian controversy. Now, the Arian controversy, which as you remember is the denial of the divinity of Christ, the saying that the Son of God is a creature, the first of the creatures of God, had a different history in the East than it did in the West. In the Greek Church, Arianism was able to be overcome rather quickly. Within a century, it had pretty much disappeared from the Greek-speaking Church. In the West, it hung around a lot longer of a time. The reason why was not because the Latin Church was divided by Arianism. It wasn't. But what happened was the western half of the Roman Empire was, beginning in the first century, overrun by all of these barbarian tribes. See, Vandals and Goths, Visigoths and Ostrogoths and all kinds of peoples, many of whom were Arians. One of the reasons why they liked being Arians, see, they were the invaders coming down into the Roman Empire, and it enabled them to have their own independent church apart from the real church. See, they didn't have to submit in any way to the imperial church, either in the Greek or the Latin form. But the eastern half of the Roman Empire was not as severely, there was some invasion there by the barbarian tribes, but not as severely overrun as the West was. Of course, Rome itself fell, and all of the what had been the Western Roman Empire was overrun by these barbarian tribes. So everywhere there is the influence of Arianism in the West, especially, and now gradually what happens, it's a great testimony to the strength of the Church's faith, gradually these Arian barbarians are converted to the Orthodox Catholic faith and renounce the Arianism. It takes a long time, takes several centuries. And the place that was hit hardest by it was Spain, because Spain was overrun by a solidly Arian tribe, the Visigoths, and they persecuted the real church for nearly a century before they were finally converted. And so one of the ways that the church found to counter Arianism, one of the tendencies that developed, and it's a natural thing that it developed this way, was to emphasize the divinity of Christ in as many ways as you can. See, and we have that, by the way, even in our church, in our prayers, it's as a kind of countering the falseness of Arius that we continually say Christ God or Christ our God. See, these every time the name of the Lord is mentioned to affirm that He is God. This comes as a result of the battle against Arianism. Just like in Orthodox churches before the controversy in the 8th century over the icons when the iconoclasts tried to remove the icons from the churches. Before that time, there was always iconography in Orthodox churches, but not as much as we have now. See, with the overthrowing of the iconoclasts and the restoring of the icons to the churches, the faithful were convinced that they were going to restore them in a way that they would never be deprived of them again. So you fill the church with them, and that's the beginning of even in the architecture. You know, we have here the icon screen, the altar screen, is an example of a kind of earlier form where the first iconostases, that expression iconostas just means icon stand, were basically pillars that made a kind of rail to set apart the altar and the sanctuary from the rest of the church, and on those pillars they would put the icons. Then it grew one step further into this structure that holds icons as the center feature, not simply pillars with icons, but as a stand to hold icons. And then in many churches, after the overthrow of the iconoclasts, of course, you had the icon screens that went all the way to the ceiling with four and five layers and covered with icons. So this, what happened in the Spanish church is, under the influence of this Trinitarian theology of Augustine, that the Holy Spirit is spoken of as the mutual love between the Father and the Son, the people in the church there, the bishops of the church there, thought, aha, if we say that the Holy Spirit proceeds not only from the Father, but from the Son too. And they would read things, you know, in the gospel that says, when Jesus says, the Holy Spirit, whom I will send you. So they say, well, Jesus says that he will send the Holy Spirit, so we can say that the Holy Spirit proceeds from him too. And if you say that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Son, just as he proceeds from the Father, see, then you're really emphasizing the divinity of the Son. You're really saying Christ is God. And it's another way to make a declaration against the false teachings of Arius. Well, the trouble is that they started to say that, and then they actually put it into the creed. See, they did something without the agreement of the universal church, changing the text of the creed to say that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. And it was resisted by the rest of the Western church for quite some time. You know, the bishop, the pope in Rome heard about it, and he said, oh no, that's not right to do that without the common mind of the church. And he even at that time had the creed inscribed on the walls of St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome without the filioque. So he was not in favor of it. But as time went on, the Latin Church insisted on this expression of the Holy Spirit proceeding from both the Father and the Son. And they, by the time of the beginning in the 9th century, were beginning to insist that the entire church should accept this innovation in the creed, this unauthorized innovation, and as we're going to see in a second, erroneous as far as our understanding faith that has not changed is. So the Orthodox Church, the church in the East, the Greek church, rejected the addition of the filioque to the creed. And those of you who were raised in a liturgical Western church, whether Roman Catholic or Episcopalian or Lutheran, and the Presbyterian and Methodist churches also use the Nicene Creed, all have experienced it with this addition, with the filioque, with saying that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, which we reject as an error and as resulting in something that is theologically and spiritually false and unbalanced. And we have to say a little about that. To speak of the Holy Spirit as proceeding from the Father and the Son, in the Orthodox understanding, subordinates the person of the Holy Spirit. And by that we mean that it speaks of the person of the Holy Spirit as being, in a sense, lesser than the Father and the Son, because he is deprived of the unique source of his being in the Father alone. And in the Orthodox understanding, the result of this is an unbalanced experience of who God is. That if the Spirit is spoken of as proceeding from the Father and the Son, therefore the danger of that is the Son is understood in a sense as greater than the Spirit. That the Holy Spirit's life in the church takes a second place to that of the Son. Now, if we look at what's happened in Western Christianity, when we look at this through Orthodox eyes, what it seems to the Orthodox that has happened as a result of the filioque and its greatest danger, the subordination of the person of the Holy Spirit, is, I'll have to give you another theological expression, and I'll explain it. It's called Christomonism. Christomonism means Christ alone, or probably one of the most extremely heretical expressions of Christomonism would be, for example, we mentioned it already in the United Pentecostal Church, the Jesus-only church, where everybody's Jesus, Father's Jesus, Son is Jesus, Holy Spirit's Jesus. But Christomonism is the experience not simply on the level of theological study, but on the level of the everyday life of the believer, that God is related to as Jesus only. And this, I can speak from my own experience, my own childhood and formation in Western Christianity. This is a great tendency, I think it can be said accurately, of Western Christianity, that frequently Western Christians, whether they be Roman Catholics or Protestants, when they speak of God or when they pray to God, this was certainly the case for me, and I don't think I am unique. I think I'd be a typical product of my upbringing in the Western Church. When I would pray to God as a child or a young adult, I was really praying to Jesus. God was Jesus. Jesus was, of course, I believed in the Father and the Holy Spirit. You know, I knew what the church taught, what the scriptures said. But as far as my own perception and experience of who God is and how we relate to him, one did not address the Father very much, because the Father is known only through Jesus. And as far as the person of the Holy Spirit is concerned, he's kind of subordinate in some way to the person of Jesus, and it's only Jesus that matters, practically speaking. That's the end result of subordinationism and Christomonism. Another way of expressing it, through Orthodox eyes, when Orthodox look at the strain in so much of contemporary Protestantism, for example, which focuses on this private relationship, the relationship of me alone with Jesus alone, which I think I've mentioned before, which in the Orthodox experience simply does not exist at all. The Christian alone has no relationship to Jesus alone in the Orthodox Church. Such a thing doesn't even exist. We don't have any kind of private relationship with a private God. God is not known privately. God is known in the communion of the persons of the Holy Trinity within the communion of the Church. That is how we know God. It's not to say that it is an impersonal or depersonalized knowledge. We know God as persons, but we do not know him as isolated individuals. And the God we know is not a Jesus isolated from the Father and the Spirit. Rather, in the experience of the Church's prayer, for example, if you look at the Divine Liturgy, you'll see that virtually all of the prayers of the Divine Liturgy are addressed to the Father. They are addressed to the Father through the person of the Son in the person of the Holy Spirit. So it is the Holy Spirit who makes the Son known, makes us to know the Son, who he is, what he has done, what he has made possible, and through the Spirit revealing the Son and the Son sending the Spirit, who proceeds from the Father, just as the Son is begotten of the Father, we know God. So the Divine Liturgy is addressed to the Father, who is the source of all, the source of the Son and the Holy Spirit on the level of the divine life outside time, and the source of the life that exists in this world, the life of the universe within time, that he creates. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, by the spirit of his mouth, all their hosts. So that is how we know God. Now, and that doesn't mean that we do not have prayers that are addressed directly to the Son. We do that. But they are, on the level of the Church's liturgical prayer, the exception. And in the prayers of the Church, there are very few prayers that are addressed directly to the person of the Holy Spirit. We have the one that kind of begins most of the services of the Church, and traditionally in the Orthodox practice of personal prayer begins the rule of personal prayer, the prayer, O Heavenly King, the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, who is everywhere present, filling all things, treasury of blessings and giver of life. Come and abide in us, cleanse us from all impurity, save our souls, O good one. We begin, that's, of course, the priest says that prayer before the Divine Liturgy, we say it before our personal prayers. We begin asking the Holy Spirit because we ask the Holy Spirit to come upon us because he it is who makes it possible for us to know the Son, and in the Son we know the Father. And then, having said that, we address most of the rest of our prayers when we pray to the Father in the Son or through the Son in the Holy Spirit. So always the life of the communion of the Holy Trinity is experienced on every level in the Church, whether it's in personal prayer, liturgical prayer, or in the highest theological contemplation. It's always this Trinitarian experience of God, which is not the product of the imagination or the intellect of man, but is the way God has revealed himself to us. Just as the prayers of Jesus in the Gospel, Jesus prays to his Father, so we pray to the Father through our relationship with Jesus, his son, as his brothers and sisters in his body, the church. And this faith that we have in Jesus the Son as the perfect image of the Father, we only have because of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So it's always this communal Trinitarian expression. And in the Orthodox eyes, the danger of saying that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son lessens the place of the Holy Spirit in the church, and even confuses the uniqueness of the person of the Holy Spirit and the uniqueness of the person of Jesus. That we see when we read the New Testament, especially, that the Son and the Holy Spirit, as the two arms of the Father, as the model of St. Irenaeus says, do different things. It's not that they are contradictory things, but they do different things. The Son takes flesh. He teaches the word of truth. He accepts man's sin and death. He dies on the cross and rises from the dead. The Holy Spirit makes known who he is. He plants the seed by his voluntary death and rising from the dead, but the Spirit makes the seed to grow. The Spirit reveals to those who belong to him who he is. So in every act of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are always involved in perfect communion, but never are the persons to be confused with one another. And in the Orthodox eyes, this filioque, in addition to being a completely non-conciliar addition to the creed that the Western Church took upon itself on its own authority without the consensus of the church to add to the creed, so that makes it objectionable on that level. We have to talk about that next week when we talk about the unity of the church. But it also is objectionable, dangerous, heretical on the theological level because it leads to an unbalanced perception and experience of who God is. So, and has been the source of one of the principal sources of the tragic departure, we would say, in the Orthodox expression, departure of Latin Christianity, both the Roman Catholic Church and the Protestant churches that proceed from Latin Christianity, from communion with the Orthodox Church, one of the central issues of that great tragedy in Christian history was the introduction of the filioque into the creed by the Western Church. So the Holy Spirit, as we confess in the creed, proceeds from the Father uniquely. With the Father and the Son, we go on to say, he is worshipped and glorified. That's to make it very clear that he is to be given the same worship as the Father and the Son, because already when the creed was being formulated, there was this tendency to speak of him in a lesser way, because perhaps the temptation that came upon some when one reads in the scripture, of course, the gospel says a great deal about the person of the Son, says a great deal about Jesus Christ. It has to. Jesus Christ is the Word, see. Through Jesus Christ is the verbal revelation. Through the words of him who is the Word in the gospel, the truth is revealed that the Father reveals in his Son. So naturally, the majority of what is said, written in the New Testament is said about the person of the Son. The person of the Holy Spirit is, we would say, on the human level, much more mysterious, you see. Comparatively little is said about him, as Jesus says in the gospel, the wind he speaks about. The wind, you don't know where it comes from, you don't know where it's going. So it is with the Spirit of God. Yet, in the Lord's own words in the New Testament. The Spirit is referred to as the living water that He gives, that will be the fountain gushing up in the heart of every one of the believers, every one of the faithful, unto life eternal. And then it goes on to say in the Gospel of John that the Spirit had not yet been given because Jesus had not yet been glorified. That in this plan of God for the salvation of the world, there is an order to how it proceeds. First, the Son is glorified by His voluntary crucifixion and resurrection. Then it is possible for the Spirit to be poured out on all flesh. So, the Spirit is worshipped and glorified with the Father and the Son, and He has spoken, the Creed goes on to say, through the prophets, that in all the prophets of the Old Testament and those who exercise the prophetic gift in the New Testament. And the prophetic gift is most precisely described as those who speak the word of truth to the church. Those who say, "Thus says the Lord," and it is God speaking through them. The breath of the Holy Spirit comes upon them, inspires them, fills them, and they speak the truth of God. And so everything that is recorded in the prophetic writings in the Old Testament, and everything that is said within the communion of the church that bears testimony to the truth of the God who reveals Himself to us, comes through the person of the Holy Spirit. So, that's a good place to conclude this evening. And we'll have some questions now. Mark.
Yes, regarding the, shall we say, the dialogue that has taken place since the 10th century, I guess, or the 9th century when this started, it seems fairly simple from our perspective to see that the reasons for doing so may have been well-intentioned but faulty. Does the Roman Church still hold to the Augustinian view of the Holy Spirit being the unity of love between the Father and the Son primarily? Have there been discussions of, because now that the issue of the deity of Christ is no longer, shall we say, a potential problem.
At least for believers.
Yes. In the Roman Church. Has there been a review of this? Has there been dialogue between the churches, and over the centuries, have they come any closer to you know, unanimity on the subject?
Recently, within the last several decades, there has been dialogue, and there have been some hopeful signs. Now, as far as the Augustinian view of the Holy Trinity, that's, to my knowledge, that has never been the official doctrine of the Roman Catholic Church or the other Western churches. It has been one, perhaps the most common explanation, the most popular explanation of the Trinity. Now, the sign of hope is this, that, we speak, as we mentioned several weeks ago, we speak of God in two ways. We speak of Him as He is in Himself, as much as we are able to. And then we speak of Him how He relates to us. And likewise, when this question of the procession of the Holy Spirit is concerned, we have to look at it in both those ways. Now, we would insist, as Orthodox, that on the level of speaking of God as He is, completely independent from creation, how He deals with creation, how He is in Himself, that it is impossible for there to be any compromise on the uniqueness of the procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father alone. Because if there is, then there is an imbalance in the Holy Trinity. Now, on the level of of God relating to creatures. It could be said that because Jesus himself in the gospel tells us that the Holy Spirit who proceeds from the Father, he will send. See, so on the level of God revealing himself to us, we could say that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and is given through the Son to us. And if that distinction is made clear, there's been some expressions of willingness on the part of certain, the current Pope John Paul II, who's had on a couple of occasions to express his desire for a reunion, between the Roman Church and the Orthodox Churches, has had the creed sung a couple times in St. Peter's without the filioque, saying, what's being stated there is that the filioque is not being interpreted by the Roman Church as a statement as an absolute doctrinal statement that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Son eternally within the being of the Godhead. And if that were to be the case, if there were to be agreement about that, my opinion, based on others that speak of this in the church, is that there could be perhaps a doctrinal reconciliation on that point. It's not impossible. However, this is maybe jumping ahead to next week, but maybe we need to establish a link between this week and next week, because it's not any accident in the creed that as soon as we speak of the Holy Spirit, the very next thing we speak of is the church. See, because it is the Holy Spirit that cements the church together. We like to say in the hymns of the church, the Holy Spirit organizes the church. We speak of the descent of the Holy Spirit on the apostles and disciples at Pentecost as the birthday of the church. That prior to the coming of the Spirit, we have the disciples who had witnessed the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, but you cannot properly speak of them as the church until the Holy Spirit has come upon them and brought them from outside perception to inside experience of what has happened. So the other result in the Orthodox eyes of the wrong kind. You see, it's difficult to express this. We would say the wrong kind of exaltation of the person of the Son. The reason why it's wrong, we would say, is that it's at the expense of another divine person. People might ask, well, how can it be possible to too much exalt Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Well, if you do it at the express of the Spirit, who is his equal, it is wrong. And it is the Orthodox perception. I say perception because it's nowhere any kind of dogmatic definition. But it is the Orthodox perception that the unbalanced understanding of the Trinity has led to an unbalanced understanding of authority in the church. See, that the subordination of the person of the Holy Spirit to the Son on the level of the divinity has resulted in the desire for a specific authority principle to be functioning on the level of the church in history, whether it is the infallible Pope, the infallible Bible, or the infallible me. See, there has to be this tangible infallible authority principle. And in Orthodox eyes, it all seems to hang together. Once the actual perception of how God has revealed himself and how that is lived out in the church, once the balance in that is lost, these kind of things creep in. We'll speak of that next week when we talk about the church.
Tim. So what's the possibility for union? Will Rome renounce the papacy, give it the proper primacy? as first of equals? I thought I'd throw out the big one there.
Well,
big roadblock.
Of course, next week we're going to speak about the church, and I'd almost rather hold because of course any discussion about the church we're going to begin next week with what is. This is just in my opinion as a teacher of Christian doctrine, Orthodox Christian doctrine. I would say that the two doctrinal issues that tend to be crucial points of passage for the person with a Western Christian past, encountering and then eventually entering into communion with the Orthodox Church. There are two things that are big issues in my experience. The first is the one that we dealt with when speaking of redemption, in not seeing Christ as the one whom the angry Father punished unto death for the sins of mankind, to have some sort of satisfaction of his justice, to get beyond that. Into the Christ whom the Father gives and who voluntarily offers himself out of love as a sacrifice unto death. That's the first. The second, of course, is the insistence of the Orthodox Church as being what we're going to talk about next week, as being the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, that there is one church in the same way that there is one God. We say in the Creed, there is one God, there is one Lord Jesus Christ, there is one church. The word one is used in all three cases, and it's used in the same sense. And that means, of course, that the Orthodox Church Church's understanding of herself is that the visible existence of the Orthodox Church in history is that one church, and the fullness of that one church is not to be found outside her. I'll express it positively. Everyone who enters into communion with the Church must willingly and freely make that confession. Someone who is in the Orthodox Church who has never made that confession, but with from the heart and the lips, is not spiritually speaking an Orthodox Christian. Is living in some sort of shadowland, some sort of hybrid shadowland. If it's a difficult confession to make, it's far more healthy to honestly face the difficulty. But we're going to talk about that. Next time, I don't
want to. Father David, a number of theologians I've read over the years tend to make the Holy Spirit the feminine part of God to answer the question of if man is created in the image of God and we have male and female he created. Would you comment on that, please?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up because usually I mention that in this session on the Holy Spirit. The word pneuma in the Greek, the spirit, is a neuter word. Of course, the word for the Father, the word for the Son, they are masculine words. Now we've said already that God is not masculine, God is not feminine, God is not neuter, God is God. God transcends our human categories of masculine, feminine, and neuter. However, the language that we use to describe him is, on its limited level, an expression of who he is. And that is to say that the masculine word, Father, and Son are the words not chosen by human beings, but chosen by God as those words through which he reveals himself. So they are unchangeable. That is to say that the Father reveals himself as Father and not Mother through all eternity. The Son is Son and not Daughter through all eternity. That does not mean, by the way, that
that the Father, God the Father, in the way he relates to us, does not show both what we would call paternal and maternal characteristics. He does. In fact, even in the Old Testament, God says, I believe it's in Hosea, that I nursed you. I nursed you like a mother. He describes his relationship to Israel as a nursing mother. And likewise, the Son of God, who is on the level of his divinity, the Son of the Father, and on the level of his humanity, when he takes flesh, becomes a human male, not a human female. This is not by accident. Nothing that God does happens by accident. In fact, as a aside in the spiritual life, if one is a Christian, we would say nothing that we do or happens to us is by accident either, because there is no room for blind fate or luck or accidents in our understanding of what life is. But certainly, Christ is incarnate as a human male for a specific reason, because there is an order in creation, just as there is an order in the divinity, that although the Son is begotten of the Father, and the Son is not the Father, and the Holy Spirit is not the Father, and it is the Father who is without origin, whereas the Son and the Spirit have their origin in the Father, so there is order in the Holy Trinity, that does not mean that there is subordination in the Trinity, you see. That does not mean that that Son and Spirit are somehow less God than the Father. Likewise, in the created order, the teaching of the Judeo-Christian revelation is that it is from the male in the creation account in the book of Genesis, which, whether we look at as literal history or whether we look at it symbolically, it doesn't matter. What's being revealed there is an essential truth, that first the man is created, then the woman is created, that the man is the icon of the head of the body, the woman is an icon of the body, that the two cannot exist without each other, that there is not meant to be any kind of subordination or subservience of the woman to the man. In fact, we would say that kind of fallen subordination that has existed in human society is a result of sin and evil, has nothing to do with what God has revealed in his order. And when we speak of the person of the Spirit, you see, we're not, and of course, we following the tradition of the church, use, following the practice of the church, use the masculine pronoun for the Spirit, even though strictly speaking, you know, if we were praying in Greek, the Spirit is not a he. Holy Spirit is not a he. The Holy Spirit, the thing is, we don't have in English a personalized it. It's one of the things that we lack. Well, the minute we say it, you know, you have an object, and it is an object, and it is not a person. Or if we use it to refer to a person, it's in an insulting way. But if there were such a thing as a personal it in English, that would be the most accurate way to speak of the Holy Spirit, person of the Holy Spirit, who in his relationship to the human race, and in his relationship to God the Father, it is different than that of the Son to the Father. The Spirit is not the Son. The Spirit is the Spirit. The Spirit's relationship to the Father is not the same relationship as the Son's to the Father. Now, one cannot ask the question, well, what is the difference? The difference is what makes God God. And that is beyond us. The Spirit's relationship to the creation is the giver and the nurturer of life. It is the Spirit who hovers or breathes or broods over the face of the waters. See, it's a kind of maternal image that's used there. And likewise, the one, of course, the one who is the giver of life in the human experience, the one who gives birth to the life is the mother. So it has not only recently, but there is a tradition, you could say, of speaking of what the spirit does in a maternal or feminine sense. But one must be very careful to leap from that to making the Holy Spirit into some sort of feminine principle. The Holy Spirit is not a feminine principle. The Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit of God and transcends all of those boundaries of masculine, feminine, and neuter. But you can see even in things like some of these customs that we have in the church, you know, there's on the Feast of Pentecost, there is the custom in the church to use the color green, the color of life, and to decorate the church with green leaves because it's the Holy Spirit who gives the life to nature and gives the life to the new creation too. And you know, it's a natural expression in our language to speak of nature in a feminine way. Mother Nature, see, we say. And there can be, I would say, an analogy there. Perhaps we would be far more accurate speaking of the Holy Spirit rather than Mother Nature. But that's not to say that the Holy Spirit is any kind of mother, the Holy Spirit is any kind of feminine person. We can say that the Son of God incarnate is a human male. We can say that the Father who dwells in unapproachable light, none of those adjectives are suitable for describing him. And we can say that the Holy Spirit as the giver and nurturer of life is a reflection of what on the human level is seen as certain aspects of femininity. But to say, as some say, that the Holy Spirit is feminine as the incarnate Jesus is masculine, for example, that's heretical. There's no incarnation of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is non-incarnate. That is trying to understand the Holy Spirit in the same way we understand Jesus. And that's the whole point. They are different. God doesn't have a son and a daughter. God the Father has the Son and the Spirit. Linda.
This isn't my question. What would be an appropriate answer to the Protestant question, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ?
The best way to answer that would be to, of course, the answer is yes. Yes, we do, of course. But personal must never be misinterpreted as meaning individual, private, something that I alone have with God or Jesus alone. That I know who God is because of how he has revealed himself in the church, through the faith of the church, in the communion of the church. Outside, that's why, you're getting lots of sneak previews of next week. That's why St. Cyprian, for example, his day was just 2 days ago, one of the Western fathers of the church says, of course, if you gave this answer to your would-be or imaginary Protestant friend, it would blow them away, and I don't recommend it, as a matter of fact. Not at first sight, not without some hope of them understanding it. St. Cyprian says you can't have God as your father without the church as your mother. No way to heaven. Personal is frequently misdefined these days as meaning private, individual, independent. See, the communion of the church is a communion of persons. We are not
we are not fused into this depersonalized soup, just as, nor will we be in all eternity. That's the whole point. See, if one is a Buddhist or a New Ager or a Hindu, eternal life means losing one's not only individuality but personality, and dissolving into the divine or the infinite. And that's why on both those levels, on the level of the persons of the Trinity, there's so much effort spent on insisting on the uniqueness of these divine persons. Because it's the way, and it's not, again, it's not the product of human intellect. It is the safeguarding of how God has revealed himself to us. That the Father is not alone, the Father has his Son and the Spirit. They share the same life, but they are distinct persons. Likewise, we who are created in their image and likeness are distinct persons. But the Father never reveals himself in any other way but through the Son and the Spirit. The Son never does anything without obedience to the Father's will. The Father says, I have no will of my own. The Son says, I have no will of my own, I do the will of my Father. It's like saying the Father is my origin. What does the Holy Spirit do? The Holy Spirit reveals the Son in whom we know the Father. It does not seem to be the Holy Spirit's business to reveal much about himself. See, the Holy Spirit is very humble that way. That's why it's, you know, the saints, in reflecting on that, when they talk about frequently how little is said in the scripture, both concerning the personality of the Holy Spirit and on the divine level, and the personality of the Virgin Mary on the human level. Yet, because the purpose of both of them, one on the divine level, one on the human level, is to bring Jesus into the world and make him known. And so Jesus is incarnate by the humble Holy Spirit and the humble Virgin Mary. It's a great thing to reflect upon sometimes. So just as even on the level of the divine persons, they are not independent of each other. They know and love and act in perfect communion. So also on the level of the human persons, this dividing of the persons into individuals, the wall of division between the human person, which it's one of the greatest signs of the fall, that how limited our ability to communicate with each other is. See, that will go away in the kingdom of God, and among the saints, that's why the saints were able to have these wonderful spiritual friendships, because they transcended the boundaries of the inability to commune in love that we have between ourselves as a result of the fall and our sins. So what will be healed is this artificial individuality. Individuality is the result of the fall. Individuality is the obscuring of personhood. Individuality is seeing oneself as independent from the others. It's the exact opposite of saying your brother is your life. Just as the Father is the life of the Son and the Spirit, so also on the level of the church, we know that only because we have the eternal communion of the Father, Son, and the Spirit, and we have the communion in the church of one another in how they have revealed themselves to us in the church. We don't have it in a corner by ourselves someplace. Even if you're a hermit in the desert, never see anybody. The reason why you can be a hermit in the desert is that you have the grace of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that has put you there to offer yourself in continual prayer for the sake of the whole world. But there's an old, I forget, this might be St. Cyprian too, who says, unus Christianus, nullus Christianus. You know, one Christian, no Christian.
You can't be a private Christian. That's why the church is not some kind of secondary tool to help us on our individual journeys to God. See, the church is not a teaching aid. The church is the life of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in their communion of love revealed to the human race. And we don't know God apart from that. We only have our imaginations, we would say. And we would say that, you know, what about those outside the church? Well, we're going to talk about that all next week. You know, the grace of God that he has given to the church in his mercy works outside the boundaries of the church. But it is the grace that he's given to his church.
Is it wrong of us then to, in our personal prayers, to just pray to one of the Trinity, or should we always keep, you know, all three persons of the Trinity in mind when we pray?
Well,
say a couple things about that.
First of all, of course, when we speak about prayer, which we will do most specifically when we've finished these classes about the Creed, and then we enter into the inner life of the Church. In fact, that's what we begin with. Well, once we begin the catechumen sessions, strictly speaking, we talk about prayer. That's why in the Orthodox tradition of prayer, especially for beginners, prayer in one's own words is not encouraged very much. It's not to say that you can't do it or that it's bad or anything like that, but what is said is that we are much better off following for our words of prayer those patterns of words that have been used by the church from the beginning, just as Jesus himself did, who prayed the Psalms, who used the formulas of Hebrew prayer, who gave his apostles a prayer. He said when they asked him to teach them to pray, he said, when you pray, say, and gave them the words of the Our Father. He didn't say, like this, or this is a model that you can each have your own individual version of. He says, when you pray, say, Our Father who art in heaven, etc. So, the prayers of the Church, whether it's the Trisagion prayers or the various other formulas of prayer, always give us a balanced focus. Even the Jesus prayer, see, which of course is addressed personally to Jesus, but it's the teaching of the Church from beginning to the end about prayer that we cannot even experience true prayer to Jesus without the presence of the Holy Spirit, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and the faith that he makes possible for us to have working within us. And in Jesus Christ, we have to realize that we see the Father, of whom the Lord Jesus Christ is the perfect image. So it's always within that Trinitarian communion. And the experience is, it is an experience. It's not an intellectual exercise, although the intellect is involved. The intellect is involved in prayer, the emotions are involved in prayer, the will is involved in prayer. But prayer cannot be reduced as to an intellectual exercise, and the experience of the saints is that if you pray in communion with the Church, and if you struggle to live your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ, to live the gospel generously, you will know the Father. Because that is the promise. You will not have to figure it out. You will know. That was the experience of the saints, and that's we're called to that same experience. It's the Holy Spirit that makes all that possible. That's why Saint Seraphim says that the whole purpose of life is the acquisition of the Holy Spirit. that there is no other purpose for us, because through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we know, not just intellectually, but know in the most deeply biblical sense, to know intimately. We know Jesus Christ, the Lord, the Son of the Father, intimately in the Holy Spirit, and because we know Him as the Son of the Father, precisely because He is the Son, we know the Father in Him. So it's a Trinitarian life.
Heavenly King, O Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, who is in all places and fills all things, treasury of good things and the giver of life, come and abide in us, cleanse us from every stain, and save our souls, O good one. God is with us through His grace and love for mankind, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Amen.